you are part of a summit. Can you explain a little bit about what that is?
Sure. Well, 2015 is the third annual summit on race. And it's a summit of people who are doing initiatives throughout the city that are responding to the problems of race in our culture, in our city, in our nation, really. It's largely supported by different groups, for example, Facing Race, Embracing Equity, and ACT Rochester, ABC, but I won't try to list the different sponsors. What's more important is that it's people who have realized that we could work together and we could get more done than working in our separate silos. There's room for things in silos, but we need to pull together.
Okay, and this one specifically is on a conversation on race and poverty?
That's right.
What's the connection between those two?
That's a good question. And that's one of the things that we ask people who come to this workshop. Because some people who are coming won't really know much about the issues. We have some sort of entry-level people. We have people who've been working on race and poverty for a long time. As you know, that there's a Rochester anti-poverty initiative out right now that's that Governor Cuomo helped to bring about. And there is a lot of poverty in Rochester, but it could be overlooked. It could be overlooked that a lot of the poverty is racially related. I've been on the Conversations on Race Committee since 2012. And at first, we were just called the Conversations on Race, because race is really the elephant in the room in a lot of things that are happening. A lot of the political, social, and economic things that happen have direct relation to race because of structural racism. And so we've had these conversations, and people get their mouths wet, their tongues wet, and they want to do more. I mean, understanding racism is more than just trying to be a good person, trying not to be prejudiced, although that's part of it. It's also finding out how, without our even knowing it, we support the racist structures of this society. It's unconscious racism. It's what they call white privilege, and it's what black folks can feel within themselves as being less. So white and black have to work. And then of course there are other races, other ethnic groups that are involved. But the basic dynamic in this country has had to do with black and white. Because since the founding of the country, black folks were seen as inferior. And they were built into the economy in a way that didn't make them human. And so we can have conversations about race, we can try to overcome our individual racism, and that's something that we all need to work on. But we also need to see how racism is built into the fabric of our society. And poverty is, well, let's see, Rochester is about 70% black. The city of Rochester, you know, this concentration of black folks decreases as you move out, you know, the near ring suburbs and then farther out. And you also see that poverty changes as you move out. So you wonder, what is that about? You know, what's happening? Are black people more poor generally than white? Also, increasingly, Hispanic people are poor and centralized in the city. So this is something for which we want answers. And people have different opinions about that. And a lot of it comes from ignorance. This idea that I mentioned about blacks being inferior, this can be held by whites and it can be held by blacks. So from different angles, both groups need to work on this. And other groups, other immigrant groups who have come in, have had to deal with this to a degree also. It's even people like the Irish, when they first came in, they were the other, you know. But particularly the darker skinned peoples, the Asians, of course the Native Americans first, you know, and Latinos have had to deal with race. So there is a connection. There is a connection in housing. The people who live in the city often are living in apartments. There's much less home ownership among people of color. And there's educational deficits in the city area. There's not enough money even to get books all the time for schools. So some of these areas interlap. You've got education, healthcare, juvenile justice. And by the way, some of the work groups in the summit are dealing with some of these issues. But all these things are related, but one underlying thing is beyond race is poverty. So poverty and how poverty is perpetuated generationally is important. With the GI Bill, of course, as most of us know, people returning from World War II got to buy nice homes. Usually they were suburban. Black people were systematically shunted away from these. They weren't able to take part in this gift of the government. And already poor, already being shunted, not being having jobs in Rochester. There's a migration of black people in the 40s, 50s to Rochester. And they ended up in certain areas of the city. They weren't able to get education and jobs and housing. This led to the riots of 64, which is very important American history now. So there are a lot of factors. So this poverty has continued. People who don't have jobs, they can't provide for their children where they would like to. They can't send them to a good school. The children might not be able to graduate from school because they might have to work, or they might have to take care of a child. If you're supposed to graduate from school, now these days they have social promotion. You can be pushed forward in the school system, and you come out and you don't know much more than you did when you're in there. The education isn't always as relevant as it needs to be. And it doesn't include the real history of the United States, which is an important part of it. But I'm digressing. These things are related to poverty, but as you can see, it's like an octopus. You know, it leaches out and it's got its eight arms, and it leaches into all kinds of areas.
You're going to be leading a breakout session. Can you tell me what that session is going to be and why you are going to not be leading it, excuse me, facilitating it, being one of the facilitators? Why are you doing this particular breakout session, and what is the breakout session? And
Well, as I said, there's a group that's done conversations on race. It's done it since 2012. They've largely been sponsored by the library, and a lot of these conversations were held in the library. Friends and Foundation of the Rochester Public Library is instrumental in that. They were affiliated with a group called RISE several years ago. If you remember, several years ago there was an exhibit at the Rochester Museum and Science Center, A Race, Are We So Different? And that was really, that's going all across the country, of course, and that was a really dynamic exhibit. Around that time, when that exhibit was coming up, people got together and said, let's try to have some conversations. This issue, it's time. Things are exploding across the country, and it's continued to do since then. Time to talk about race right out in the open. So we did that. I wasn't initially with the group. I came in around many months after the group had started. But it didn't take long to realize that we needed some higher level conversations. People were coming in not knowing anything about racial disparity and structural racism. And it was really important to start the conversation, but people might want to get a better bite on what they could do and how things really work with the physical structures of racism in Rochester. And so we felt that we needed to have higher level conversations. So we looked at different areas like the justice system, health, education. And partly because the poverty initiative was going on, we said poverty is really an important one to work on, and it's very relevant right now. So we started that, and we haven't actually done our first conversation on race with poverty. We've just done the conversations on race. So this is a new framework, but it's very much like the other one. People will come in, and there'll be they'll introduce themselves, we'll kind of warm up to each other, and we'll do some of their work in large groups and some of their work in small groups. At the summit, there are only going to be 25 people per breakout group, people who come to the group, and there will be facilitators. And I believe the 25 includes the facilitators. So some work we'll be able to do in the big group, and some will break up into dyads or triads or slightly larger groups to do. We'll be looking at, we'll first make some ground rules that the group decides upon for the conversation so that we can talk without fighting. And then we'll look into the question. The first question is, what links do you see between race and poverty? And we'll break up in small groups to do that. And then we'll bring what we've learned from each other back to the general group. Then we'll work on how do you think this can be addressed? And we'll have some smaller groups there and come back. Some of this is more spontaneous, and we'll tweak it. Since we've done a lot of these conversations before, it might not run exactly like this. And if people don't have a lot to say, we'll offer them something like, "What do you think about the concept of urban suburban programs in schools? What do you think about low-income housing or mixed-income housing coming to where you live?" So we'll ask questions that could make people start to talk a little bit, and then help people to react with each other, respond, not react. And then finally, we'll talk about what'll it take for you to be able to talk with somebody else about this issue, informed and intelligent, and mostly open and giving, so that we can spread the conversation.
This is open to everybody?
Yes.
And I'm assuming you want a variety of people, or?
Yes, we do. We'd like a variety of people. We want white people to come to give what they have to say. We want black people to come. Often black folks are a little tired of thinking about race. They tend to think about race a lot more than whites. So I'm encouraging black people to come, because we need to integrate this so that we can see each other. We need to all be able to see each other. And it's helpful if everybody's there. And we've been trying to bring in more Hispanic groups also, Hispanic people, as well as other races.
Initiative fit in with or complement the other summit breakout sessions?
Well, it complements them in the sense that you can see there's work on education, and there is an education work group. Let's see if I know what their goals are. Well, I talked a little bit about education. There are issues of history that in education. There are issues of how people are taught. The ratios of teachers to students as far as their race is concerned. And a lot of these are tied into there not being enough black teachers, with there being a high concentration of poverty and black people in Rochester. So poverty is tied in with the educational system. There's also a workshop on the school-to-prison pipeline. Of course, that's tied in with poverty, because people don't graduate often in order to make money. In my neighborhood, which is near Conkey Avenue, there are a lot of drug dealers, and I don't feel comfortable turning them into the police anymore. I realize these guys are making a living. Not everybody is doing it just to make a living. You know, some people have actually gotten used to the life, but why? You know, this doesn't just happen, you know, spontaneously. It's because of decades and decades of generational poverty. So readdressing power imbalances through cultural humility is, with witnessing whiteness is something. This is difficult because it talks about white privilege, and because white people don't usually have to deal with the issues that black people have to deal with. They tend to go to better schools, so they don't have to deal with a school system that's fighting for money. It's hard to recognize this if you've been in a white culture all your life. And so people feel that they're being attacked when they say, white people feel that they're being attacked when they say that the system is racist. And so this workshop will help people to realize that our racism is something that's built in. And people who say they aren't prejudiced need to understand that they can be prejudiced without even knowing, without even having a hateful bone in their body, they could be prejudiced. So the witnessing whiteness will help us with that and help people who have more and people who have less to understand each other. Achieving the American dream, you can see how that's related. Developing authentic alternatives from the streets to jobs. So all these workshops are related. You know, we could have taken probably any one and spun it out to include the others.
Okay. How do you go about making it a safe and comfortable environment for people to engage on such a issue that's kind of tough to talk about?
Mm-hmm. We have the group, in the beginning of our conversation, set up guidelines. We'll ask the group what they would like the guidelines to be. Usually people say that they want confidentiality. And we've had long discussions about whether things should be confidential or not, but we think that the conversations group thinks that confidentiality is important, because then people will say more. Trying to be open is another guideline that people have. Sort of saying, ouch. Now, if somebody says something that you feel is a dig, get out there and say, wait a minute, that hurt me. And then that can be brought up. There are other guidelines that may come up that we don't even know are going to come up that might be particular to that group. And all these things are decided in the beginning. We'll usually put them down on a little board. This is what we are going to do to make the conversation safe. And even the idea of safety has been challenged in groups. You know, it doesn't mean that it won't hurt, and it doesn't mean that, but it doesn't mean that you won't be beat up. And it does mean, another guideline that we usually have is that, well, let somebody talk, and then you can respond. So everybody gets a turn. And that's one problem with a lot of conversations that we have. People start going off. Even if you get angry, you need to listen to what the other person says, and then respond, and have your turn to respond.
If people are interested in the summit,
mm-hmm.
How can people get involved in it?
Yes.
And when is it going to be?
Thank you. It's September the 26th, and that is, it's a Saturday, yes. Actually, let me make sure I have this. That's a Saturday, September the 26th. It's going to be from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. And it's going to be at the Wilson Foundation Academy, which, you know, the old Wilson High, 200 Genesee Street.
And where can people go to get more information and to see the different sessions, and because they have to sign up for a specific one?
Yes, we're encouraging people to sign up online. It's really very helpful in organizing the breakout sessions. So to sign up for the summit, go to www.faceracerock. That's face, F-A-C-E, race, R-A-C-E, rock, R-O-C, .org. And it's /summit2015. Another thing you can do is call 325-5116, I believe that's ABC, extension 1732, and you can get more information there.
Okay, and is there a cost for this?
Oh, it is free.